Listening Library presents We're Not From Here by Geoff Rodkey. Read for you by Dani Martineck. 1. The Giant Bug Rumor. The first time I heard anything about Planet Choom, we'd been on Mars for almost a year. I was sitting in the rec center with Naya and Jens. We were taking a break from shooting a video we'd written. It was either How to Be Your Own Pet or Top 10 Toilets of the Mars Station. I can't remember which. Naya leaned in over the table and whispered, like she was telling us a big secret. My dad says they found a planet humans can live on permanently. Like, we can breathe the air and everything. But the thing is, she looked around to make sure nobody else was listening before she went on. There's already aliens there, and they look like giant bugs.
What kind of bugs? Jens asked.
I don't know, said Naya. I think mosquitoes.
Are they dangerous? Like, do they have stingers? A planet full of giant mosquitoes sounded terrifying.
Naya shook her head. They don't act like mosquitoes, they just look like them. And they're really smart.
As smart as humans?
Yeah, like maybe even smarter.
Are they friendly?
I guess. I mean, they know we exist, and they haven't tried to kill us or anything.
I'd rather just go to Novo, I said.
This was a few months after the Governing Council had announced they'd discovered Novo in a nearby solar system. It was a planet that could almost but not quite support human life, and the GC was studying whether they could terraform it, which meant changing its environment enough for us to live there.
Naya snorted. Novo's never going to work, she said, shaking her head. If it could, we'd all be headed there by now.
Not necessarily, I told her. Novo's really far away, so they have to be sure. And it's hard to study it from here. Plus, they need time to get all the biosuspension pods ready. The trip to Novo would take 15 Earth years, and the only way for a whole ship full of people to survive the trip without running out of food and water was to go into biosuspension. Supposedly, that was just like going to sleep, except it lasted much longer and you barfed a lot when you woke up.
Is that what your mom told you?
No. It was in the weekly announcements. My mom doesn't tell me anything. Mom had been elected to the Governing Council when it got set up, right after the first refugee ships arrived on Mars. It was a big deal, I guess, but it didn't get my family any special treatment or inside info. All it meant for me was that I never saw Mom, because she was always working.
I'm just gonna go back to Earth, Jens announced.
I rolled my eyes as Naya sighed.
You can't go back to Earth,
she told Jens for about the 40th time.
Why not?
Everybody there is dead.
So?
So nobody can live there anymore.
Nuh-uh, Jens insisted. We can live there again. We just have to wait a while.
Yeah, like 1,000 years.
Nuh-uh, just a year or two. My dad said so.
Your dad's wrong.
No, he's not.
They probably would have kept arguing until Jens started to cry, which was what usually happened when we tried to change his mind about Earth. But just then, an old man passed by our table. He must have been on one of the last ships to arrive because his face was pockmarked with dark red sores from radiation exposure. When he saw us, he stopped and looked down.
You kids making another one of your videos?
Yes, sir. I smiled at him, and he smiled back. Whenever we made a new video, the guy who ran movie night at the rec center played it on the big screen before the main feature. We'd done about half a dozen of them, and they turned Naya, Jens, and me into minor celebrities among the 100 or so people who usually showed up for the movie.
Keep it up, the man told us. Folks need to laugh, now more than ever.
Not too many people laughed at the last one, Naya reminded him. I'd written fabulous fashion looks for fall myself, after I outgrew everything I'd brought from Earth and my parents sent me to the clothing exchange. All they had in my size were a pair of worn-out jeans with mysterious stains on them, and a grimy t-shirt that said Taylor Swift World Tour 2028.
Now I was stuck wearing them, even though the stains grossed me out and I'd never even listened to Taylor Swift. So I wrote a video making fun of the clothing exchange, but it came out more angry than funny, and people didn't like it nearly as much as our other ones.
Was that the one about the clothes?
The old man grimaced in sympathy.
Yeah, that was a bit of a misfire, but don't let it get you down. You know what they say, dying's easy, comedy's hard.
People say that? I'd never heard it before. To be honest, it seemed a little inappropriate.
They used to, back in my theater days. Guess it made more sense back then,
he chuckled.
Point is, you just keep up the good work. You're raising people's spirits. We need all the joy we can get around here.
Then he put a scarred hand on my shoulder and lowered his head a little closer to mine.
Speaking of which, I heard a rumor.
I knew what was coming next even before he said it.
Is your sister Ila Mifune from that pop singer show?
Yes, sir. Ila had been playing guitar and singing since she was 6. By 12, she was writing her own songs. At 16, she went to an open audition for Pop Singer, the highest-rated TV show in our country. She made it all the way through to the semifinals, where she sang one of her own songs, Under a Blue Sky, to a TV audience of 60 million people. Going into the live final episode, she had more votes than any of the other contestants. But the world had been slowly falling apart for a while. And 2 days before the episode was supposed to happen, it suddenly fell apart a lot faster. Instead of going to the airport and flying to see Ila in the Pop Singer finale, we wound up at the spaceport, where we were lucky enough to get seats for all 4 of us on a ship to Mars. Most people weren't that lucky. The man brightened when I told him Ila was my sister. People always did, just like they always looked crushed after they got the answers to their follow-up questions.
You think she might grace us with that beautiful voice of hers?
She doesn't sing anymore, sir. I'm sorry.
Not at all?
Not really, no. Says she doesn't like to perform without a guitar.
Got to be one around here somewhere.
No, sir. Mars has no guitars.
She can still sing, though, can't she?
I nodded. Yes, sir. But her heart's just not in it right now. The rest of her wasn't either. Most days, my sister wouldn't even get out of bed. She'd just lie in her bunk, watching old episodes of The Birdleys and Ed and Fred on her screen. Having one of us in there 24/7, although on Mars it was technically more like 25/7, made our shoebox-sized living compartment feel even more cramped and stuffy than it already was. Worse, Ila wasn't even nice about it. She barely looked at me except to snarl whenever I asked her to put on headphones or move her feet so I could get into our drawer. I was pretty fed up with her moping, but Mom and Dad said I should feel sorry for her. When something this terrible happens, Mom told me during one of the rare times when we were alone, it affects people in different ways. Ila hasn't been able to bounce back from it like you have. We've just got to give her time. Personally, I thought a year, although on Mars it was technically more like half a year, should be plenty of time to bounce back. But Ila didn't seem like she was even trying. Sometimes when I came into our compartment, I'd catch the sound of one of her songs coming out of her screen. She always shut it off right away, but I suspected that when nobody else was around, she was watching her old TV performances over and over again. It didn't seem like a healthy thing to do. Even so, when strangers like the old man asked about Ila, I smiled at them and lied a little. I think she'll sing again soon, I told him. She just needs time.
Well, you tell her she's got some big fans on this station, he said, giving my shoulder a friendly little squeeze.
I will, sir. Thank you.
Thank you. You kids have a good day now. Keep up the good work.
He ambled off toward the library.
How is your sister? Naya asked me.
Angry. Dad started making her go to the exercise room every morning. Angry's better than depressed, right? Jens asked.
I don't know. She's not as mean to me when she's just depressed.
Maybe she's jealous because you're more famous than she is now, said Naya.
That's ridiculous.
Ela's much more famous than me.
Not as a percentage. Naya tapped her screen open. Think about it. 60 million people watched that show she was on, right?
But that was out of 9 billion people on Earth.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.